Next topic is delegated legislation. What happens? Day by day function of the government is expanding because of changing philosophy of the government from laissez-faire to social security state. So the function of the government is expanding day by day, and because of that, legislative function of the government is also expanding. So there is need to delegate the powers of legislation also. When legislature delegates his own powers to subordinates, that is known as delegated legislation. So here delegation is an act of entrusting a person with the power of empowering. For what purpose? To act on behalf of that person who has given him that power to act as his agent or representative. So we'll discuss with some live example. Parliament is having power for legislation. So in 1948, Parliament legislated in ESIC Act 1948. So after legislating the act, there are so many provisions given that the act will come in force from the date decided by the executives. So this is the delegated legislation. The act will be functional from the board of the ESIC, and board will be constituted by the ESIC. Now the parliament delegates its power for formation of the board to ESIC. So generally what happens, act is framed by parliament. Based upon that, rules are framed by ministry, that is labor ministry. Based upon that, regulations are framed by department. Act is only frame. What to do, what not to do. For what purpose this is made, that is the act. How the act should be made functional, that is the duty of rule making power. So rule making power is given to executives, generally ministries. So here labor ministry frames the rules for functionality of the ESIC Act. And then the original function, the original execution of the act is on the head of the ESIC, and for that ESIC frames regulations. Regulations cannot go beyond the rules of the ministry. Rules cannot go beyond the act of the parliament. So these all are within the line only, and that is known as delegated legislation. Even in our department also, many powers are delegated. For appeal, power is given to power is with RD. If there is some procedure, there is some rule, the RD can delegate his powers to DDIC, JDIC, director, somebody else. Likewise, in administration also, many powers are with the DD admin. If he wishes, he can delegate some powers to admin superintendent. So like that, delegation of power is one way facilitating, one way entrusting a person, one way it's power sharing, empowering the inferior person also. So here classification of delegated legislation is there. So classification can be based upon title based, purpose based, authority based, discretion based. Now the very debated topic, that is administrative tribunal. Whenever departmental problems are there, administrative problems are there, people have second option to go to administrative tribunal. Why I am telling second option? Because first option is always with the department. If you exhaust the department requirement, then only you should go to tribunal. So here administrative tribunals are there. So purpose of the jurisdiction of the administrative tribunal is for adjudication of disputes with respect to recruitment and condition of service of the person appointed to public service and post. That means almost all things, all recruitment, discharge, leave, transfer, promotion, everything which is related to condition of the service. Yes, if condition of service provides that after 5 years you will become AD, and if department fails, then the question arises to move to administrative tribunal, wherever some department bias is there with respect to service conditions, recruitment and service conditions, then one can go to administrative tribunal. All central government employees and employees of 45 other organizations notified by central government, they can only go to central administrative tribunal. So central administrative tribunal is exclusive quasi judicial body made for the purpose of recruitment and other service conditions of the person appointed to public service and post, and it is made for all central government employees and 45 other organizations notified by central government. If central government has not notified, that organization employee cannot move to administrative tribunal. Now the question arises, once already Supreme Court is there, High Court is there, district courts are there. So when everywhere courts are there, what is the need of administrative tribunal? So for that we have to understand difference between administrative tribunal and normal tribunal, normal courts. So a court of law is a part of the traditional judicial system. Court of law is a part of traditional judicial system, wherein judicial powers are derived from the state. State gives powers. Whereas tribunals, administrative tribunals, are an agency created by the statute and invests with the judicial powers. That means some special statutes are enacted by the parliament. For example, here Administrative Tribunal Act 1985 was passed, and this empowers the central government employees to knock the door of the administrative tribunal. Here the civil suits have jurisdiction power to try all suits of civil nature, unless the organization or unless the cognizance is expressly or impliedly barred. Unless and until cognizance of some act or omission is barred, civil suits are empowered to try all suits of civil nature. Whereas tribunals are known, empowered to try all cases of special matter which are conferred on them by statutes. Statutes decide what matter to be decided by tribunal, what not to be decided. And that is why it is quasi judicial also. Quasi judicial means tribunals are not pure courts. They don't follow all the procedures of the court. Third is, judges of the ordinary courts of law are independent of the executive in their respective tenure, terms and term conditions, whereas judiciary is independent of executives. Here judiciary is totally separate, and judiciary, all judicial officers are independent of executive and legislatures as far as court of law is concerned. Whereas tenures, terms, conditions of the service of the members of administrative tribunals are entirely in the hands of executive. So government desires, he can change the judges of the tribunals. Government desires, they can deput some better judges in the tribunal for the sake of the person affected. Then president of the court of law is trained in law. So they are law trained. Either everywhere some judicial training centers are there. They have done LLB, LLM. They have some legal background. They have some court background. They have some advocacy background. Whereas tribunals, the president or a member of the tribunal may not be trained as well in law. He may be an expert in the field of administrative matter. So any person who is expert in the field of administrative matter, whether he is law qualified or not, doesn't matter. He can be deputed as a judge in tribunal. So tribunals are quasi judicial. They don't follow all the rules of CRPC, CPC and evidence. If they follow same rules of CPC, CRPC, evidence, then there is no difference between tribunal and normal court of law. So normal court of law is very expensive. Tribunals are relatively less expensive. Normal court of law, they take longer time to dispose of a case, whereas in tribunals, some time frame is given and it is expected that they will take the decision very fast because their area is fixed. They are deciding only and only service matters. No other matters are given to them. So once it is service matters and they are a specialist in the field, so they can decide the matters expediently. Now there is one terminology known as ombudsman. What happens? In our country, corruption has been, not only in our country, democracy has always been overturned by the corruption. Many corrupt persons, they are having power and they misutilize their powers and authority. To overcheck them, requirement of ombudsman was filled. Ombudsman means Lokpal. In central government, it's a Lokpal. In a state government, it's a Loka Ayukt. So, an ombudsman is an official who is appointed by government to investigate individuals' complaints against a company, financial institution, business, organization, especially a government department or public utilities, and attempts to resolve raised concern either by process of mediation or giving recommendations. So, this is the job of the ombudsman. He takes care of the individual complaints against the government. So, in India, in central government, the Lokpal and Loka Ayukta Act 2013 was enacted to establish Lokpal for the union and Loka Ayukta for the state to perform the function of ombudsman in India. What is the need for such institution? As I stated, in our country, corruption is the main reason for maladministration. The person who is having money and if he is ready to keep the other party happy, then so many things becomes easier. The person who cannot afford, the things become difficult. So that is the part of maladministration, and that is because of the corruption. The public organizations are slow and do not have efficiency just because of the corruption. In everywhere public department, once somebody goes, they will tell because of a scarcity of manpower, shortage of manpower, this job will take 1 month, 2 months, 1 year, 2 years. Staff has not come. He is on leave. He has gone to transfer. He has gone to course. Something they will take. And the moment you make him satisfied what he needs, then and there they will do the job. So that is there. The public organizations are, that is why it is told that public organizations are slow and do not have efficiency just because of the corruption. Just because of the corruption they are avoiding. The anti-corruption agencies are mostly not independent. 10 years ago, it was told that CBI is a caste parent, which speaks in the master's voice only. So CBI is under control of the government. If government, whatever government says, CBI generally has to listen to. So that is why there was need of some independent authority. Many of these agencies exist only for giving recommendations which are not followed most of the times. There is no superior authority to check the functionality of the institutions. Moreover, the employees are also not accountable for their faults. So that is why post of ombudsman was created. The post of ombudsman was created to overcome the scenario of corruption so that maladministration can be reduced and better administration can be